The next item of business is consideration of business motion 12946 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to the business programme. Any member who wishes to speak on the motion should press their request to speak button now, and I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak on the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 12946 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions. I'd like to get in as many members as possible, so short and succinct questions and responses would be appreciated. And at question number one, I call Sarah Boyack.
To ask the Scottish Government what potential impact the proposed Berwick Bank offshore wind farm not being included in the Contracts for Difference allocation round 6 will have on achieving Scotland's climate targets.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
The Government's commitment to ending Scotland's contribution to global emissions as soon as possible remains unwavering, and we're making progress to our 2045 target, with Scotland around halfway to this goal already. A significant part of this success has been driven by our renewable energy industry, and Scotland is becoming a renewable powerhouse with 87.9% of electricity generation coming from zero or low-carbon resources in 2022. Scotland's decarbonisation plans and green jobs potential will be further boosted by the 6 projects consented by the Scottish Government in time for the Contract of Difference Allocation Round 6 application window.
Sarah Boyack.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer, but say that the Berwick Bank offshore wind farm has the potential to create over 4,500 jobs, from engineers and technicians to jobs at the beginning of the supply chain. So what action is the Scottish Government doing to reduce consenting application timescales, and will the Minister confirm when a consenting decision on Berwick Bank will actually be made?
Minister.
We have a strong record in delivering robust consents and have to date consented all of the offshore wind applications we have received. And while this does not mean every application in the future will be successful, it does demonstrate that consents are granted where it is possible to balance the environmental and development aspects. Now, of course, the Berwick Bank application is a complex project, and any decision by the Scottish Ministers must fully consider both the positive contribution to net zero targets alongside the possible impacts to the natural environment and other users of the sea. And the Member is right, of course, it is a majorly significant project for Scotland, and we will continue to work with the applicant and all those others who have expressed a view going forward.
Sarah Boyack.
Can I say I'm disappointed that the Minister didn't acknowledge the importance of consenting timeframes. Last month I visited Forth Ports, where considerable private investment is already being made to ensure our renewables infrastructure is ready to go and attract manufacturing to Scotland. A great example of businesses investing in Scotland, but they need signals and support from the Government to have confidence in making that investment. And the consenting of projects like Berwick Bank is a signal industry is keeping a close eye on, particularly those in the supply chain. So will the Minister say what is being done to reduce the timescales of consenting applications because of the concern in the sector, given that the energy strategy has been delayed?
Minister.
We devote significant resources to ensuring that we deal with all applications, and the Member mentioned one other of many exciting projects being put forward across the country at the moment. And of course, none of us want to be in a position where we're dragged through the courts because anything was done inappropriately or certain views weren't taken into account and legislation adhered to in terms of impact on habitats and the wider environment. And the Member will be aware these are extremely important issues. We do not want to get this wrong. Every application has to be assessed properly, and that's why there's a proper process in place. But in terms of signals to the industry, I did say in my answer that there's 6 significant projects have just been given consent for this application round, including 2 floating offshore wind projects. 1 Green Vault, of course, was warmly welcomed, particularly in northeast Scotland, with the developers estimating that has a value of £3 billion. That is a majorly internationally significant project that's got consent from the Scottish Government. I think that's a very powerful signal that Scotland's sending out.
Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's very welcome that a number of offshore renewable projects in Scotland are now secured by relevant consents and marine licences, including the Green Vault offshore wind project that the Minister mentioned. Can I ask the Minister if he can provide any further information on what assessment the Scottish Government has made of the environment and economic impacts which these projects are anticipated to have?
Minister.
I thank Audrey Nicholl for the question. As I indicated in my previous answer to Sarah Boyack, the Scottish Government does have a robust process for offshore renewable energy project consent applications, including for Pentland and the Green Vault offshore wind farm referred to by the member in terms of these type of applications. And that includes environmental impact assessments undertaken by the applicants, which assess significant impacts to the environment, and the Habitats Regulations Appraisal, which assesses impacts to protected sites. Consultation is also undertaken with a range of statutory and non-statutory consultees, including Nature Scot, the Statutory Nature Conservation Body, and in the case of Green Vault, a derogation case as part of that HRA, the Habitats Regulations Appraisal, was also undertaken to secure compensation for any adverse effects to protected sites.
Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As we've heard already, consent times is a huge issue for this project, 17 months so far with no decision. So can I ask if the Scottish Government has plans to streamline the necessary regulatory and administrative processes to expedite the approval and implementation of offshore wind programmes like Berwick Bank, and if so, by when? And can I ask that communities are not sidelined by any changes brought forward and a balance is sought?
Minister.
Well, where I do agree with Douglas Lumsden is a balance does have to be sought, and there are very big, complex applications in many cases, such as the Berwick Bank application, and of course other big applications did get consent, and I mentioned the Green Vault application for an internationally significant floating offshore wind farm with a value of £3 billion, which his constituents in North East Scotland warmly welcomed over the last day or two. It's such a significant project for that region in particular of the country. So we always look for ways to ensure it's more efficient, it's properly resourced in terms of the consents process. But I think, as I said before, the fact we have six significant projects have just been given consent sends out a powerful signal that we are taking this as seriously as we can and will continue to support an efficient and effective consents process.
Willie Rennie.
The Minister doesn't seem to be that bothered that the target consenting time of 12 months has been exceeded by far, up to 17 months. And this will send quite a significant message to the industry who are looking for confidence that the government's got the capacity to deal with this. Now, we've got the ScotWind applications that will be coming through soon. We've not seen anything yet in terms of the number of applications that will be forthcoming. Now, the Minister, one of his colleagues, has told me extra staff have been recruited, but it's clearly not enough. So how many extra staff are going to be recruited, and will that 12-month target date be met for the ScotWind applications?
Minister.
Ministers are always looking at the level of resources applied to the consents process because, of course, we recognise the national significance of these projects. But as I said, there are some projects that are far more complex than other projects, and we are going as fast as we can in terms of the process, but the process has to be done properly, it has to be robust, and we have to avoid a situation where we end up with further years being lost going through court cases because we didn't get this right. We're going through a green revolution at the moment in Scotland, particularly in offshore renewables. There's many applications in the pipeline. There's many have been consented. This is a national effort. It's of national importance. But the member's right. We have to keep reviewing how we do this to improve things as we go forward. But as I said before, I believe the fact we've given six major projects consent, which are going to deliver billions of pounds in value from these projects and jobs the length and breadth of Scotland, is a good sign that we are taking this very seriously.
Brief supplementary, Daniel Johnson.
In emphasising the six consented projects, the Minister is emphasising outcomes. The issue here is about pace and throughput. Given that we need to double our offshore wind generating capacity, is the Minister confident that we can meet that doubling that we need to achieve by 2030?
Minister.
Well, I think we're making great progress, but the Scottish Government cannot predict how many objections or concerns will be expressed in relation to any one particular application. So, of course, you have to wait and see how the process develops as it goes forward. You have to make sure that process is robust, it's efficient, yes, it's well-resourced as well. But as I said before, we have a very significant number of projects, some of which are complex, going forward that have been consented, that are going to help us achieve our net zero targets, deliver thousands of jobs for Scotland, and potentially hundreds of millions, if not billions, of investment for the country.
Question number two, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government, in light of reported statistics indicating that wet wipes contribute up to 94% of sewer blockages, what assessment it has made of the potential impact on Scottish water of the planned ban on wet wipes containing plastic, including whether water and sewerage charges will be reduced in the future as a result of the ban?
Minister Lorna Slater.
I was pleased this week to announce that we will introduce regulations to ban wet wipes containing plastic this year. This follows a UK-wide consultation in which 95% of respondents agreed with our proposals. As well as having a positive impact on our natural environment, the member is right to point out the potential wider benefits. However, significantly reducing sewer blockages requires consumers to stop flushing wet wipes into the sewers, whether they contain plastic or not. Any savings made will allow our publicly owned Scottish Water to invest in ageing infrastructure elsewhere so that it is fit for the future and able to continue to adapt to climate change.
Stuart McMillan.
I thank the Minister for that reply, and certainly I agree with her regarding wet wipes. They are a problematic source of marine litter, and I've seen that firsthand in my constituency when I deal with the beach cleanups. But can the Minister outline how much plastic this ban is likely to prevent polluting our marine environment?
Minister.
Our previous bans introduced on single-use plastics have already been effective in reducing beach litter. Approximately 30.5 billion wet wipes are sold annually across the UK, and 64% of these include plastic within them. While we do not know the exact quantity of plastic in total, nor the proportion of these wipes that could have been incorrectly and irresponsibly flushed and potentially pollute our marine environment, we do know that we are helping to reduce the risk of harm from plastic pollution by removing approximately 19.5 billion of these products from the market.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, and once again, thank the Minister for that reply. And certainly, this ban isn't only a positive step forward for the planet, but also it should ensure that Scottish Water spends less resources on blockages, as they have reported that it costs around £7 million of bill payers' money each year to respond to the problem. So can the Minister therefore comment on whether there is scope for water and sewerage charges to be reduced or even have a lower level of increase in the future, based on the assumption that this ban will actually help save Scottish Water money?
Minister.
Decisions on household water charges are a matter for the Scottish Waters Board, with approval from the Independent Economic Regulator. However, as indicated in my answer to the member's question, any savings made will allow Scottish Water to invest in infrastructure to ensure it can continue to adapt to climate change.
Thank you. Question number three, Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the LGBT Youth Scotland pilot programme to introduce youth clubs in schools.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
Presiding Officer, I can confirm that LGBT Youth Scotland are not undertaking a pilot programme to introduce youth clubs in schools.
Megan Gallagher.
Minister, it's been widely reported that Scottish primary schools are appointing children as LGBT champions and asking pupils as young as four if they are transgender. This is part of a project set up by LGBT Youth Scotland and is funded by this Scottish Government through taxpayers' money. Parents are outraged by some of the materials that have been distributed by schools who have signed up to these youth clubs. My understanding is that LGBT Youth Scotland's charitable constitution clearly states that the age range covered by activities is 13 to 25 years old. That, of course, is out with the age of a child in primary school. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to confirm if LGBT Youth Scotland is in breach of its charitable constitution, and does she have any grip on what's happening in our schools?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the substantive part of Megan Gallagher's question, of course, Presiding Officer, was whether or not I could provide an update today on LGBT Youth Scotland piloting a programme to introduce youth clubs in schools. And as I have already stated in my original response, that is not the case at the current time. And I hope that that is recorded on the record and the member will understand that. But more broadly, we do know that LGBT groups in schools can play a really important role in ensuring LGBT young people are included within their school communities. Those are established by schools themselves as part of an inclusive approach to education. I'm sure Ms Gallagher may have met with some of those groups in some of her visits to local schools. But that's really aligned with ensuring that all of our children and young people are able to be included and engaged at school, and can be crucial, I think, in tackling anti-LGBT incidents, which we all know are on the increase. That is something I would hope every member in this chamber could support.
Megan Gallagher.
I mentioned in my last question that parents are concerned by the LGBT Youth Scotland scheme. That is not coming from me. That is coming from parents who are speaking to me about these issues, and they want these issues voiced in Parliament. Recent reports have also outlined that a mother had to change her daughter's school after it emerged within months of joining an LGBT club. She announced in a Christmas card to her family that she had become a trans son and signed off with the preferred name. The problem is that the school did not tell the parents that her daughter had been using a different name in school for months. This was also a school that had signed up to the charter scheme run by the SNP-funded charity LGBT Youth Scotland. This government has slowly been eroding the role of parents in school settings, and you only need to look at the Named Persons Act as a prime example. Why won't this government allow kids to be kids? So will the Cabinet Secretary review the LGBT Youth Scotland programme to make sure that young people are provided with appropriate materials and to ensure parents are not excluded from a child's learning experience?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I thank Ms Gallagher for her supplementary question. Of course, I think she's referring to the LGBT Youth Charter, of which, of course, it is up to individual schools whether or not they wish to undertake the LGBT Youth Charter for Education. I would note, though, for the record, Presiding Officer, that back in July 2022, Megan Gallagher signed a motion from her parliamentary colleague, Jackson Carlaw, congratulating Eastwood High School in Newton Mearns on receiving the LGBT Charter at silver level, acknowledging the efforts, dedication and hard work of both pupils and staff to achieve this prestigious award from LGBT Youth Scotland, welcoming the training and a review of policies, practices and resources at the school to ensure Eastwood High strives to go beyond meeting legislative requirements. I don't know, Presiding Officer, why Megan Gallagher has changed her mind about the charter in the interim 2 years. I can hear chuntering from a sedentary position, but I think it worthwhile recording on the record. Now, to the substantive point in relation to parental contact, the guidance is very clear that if a young person does not discuss those matters with their family, the school can support the young person about how to have that conversation and when. But they should not take that decision for the young person concerned.
Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Would the Cabinet Secretary agree that the best way to combat discrimination is to tackle prejudice before it can take root? And it is for that reason that Scotland's schools must be an inclusive and positive environment for LGBT plus pupils.
Cabinet Secretary.
I would absolutely agree with the points made by the member, and of course worthwhile remembering on the record, Presiding Officer, that Scottish schools were not always a safe space for LGBT young people during the days of Section 28 when I was at school. We are committed to doing everything we can to make Scotland the best place to grow up for the LGBTQ plus community, and educational settings have a lot to contribute in that regard, and it's really vital we all help to instil the values of respect and tolerance in our children and young people, which is why we have made significant progress in embedding LGBT education across the curriculum rather than in specific LGBT lessons. That will improve the learning environment for all children and young people. And it's also worthwhile recalling that during the last session of Parliament, this approach, inclusive education, was supported on a cross-party basis.
And Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I mean, I wish there were LGBT youth clubs when I was at school. Perhaps I wouldn't have had such a miserable time of it or left school so early. And I do understand the importance of being an inclusive environment. However, I think it is fair to say that it is all the material that children have access to is age-appropriate. I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary could explain how the government is monitoring that. And also, any parents that do have concerns about any of the material that their children have access to have a direct access to voice those concerns or indeed exclude such material from being in front of their children. I think we all want to do the right thing on this, but I think it's also fair to raise any concerns that parents might have to ensure that there's trust in the system in its entirety.
Cabinet Secretary.
Absolutely, and of course during the last session of this Parliament I worked with the member on this matter, and I very much support the concerns that he's raised today in relation to parents' rights, of course, in engaging with schools. That's why, of course, the National Parent Forum and Connect Scotland were directly involved in relation to the development of this guidance, which I think worthwhile putting on the record. We know for our children and young people in school at the current time, from a recent report which published last year, that 67% of participants reported experiencing homophobic, biphobic or transphobic bullying during their time in school. And this can also have an impact on their educational attainment, Presiding Officer. So it's really important that we do seek to work on a cross-party basis on these issues to improve the lives of our LGBT young people for the better.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions. There'll be a brief pause before we move on to the next item of business. Point of order, Jackson Carlaw.
Presiding officer, this is a minor point, but I do seek your guidance because I'm just slightly confused. At the start of each session of Parliament, the political parties are furnished with a seating plan in relation to the disposition of our seating arrangements in this Parliament, which we've always sought to observe. I'm keen to know whether that is in fact just advisory or whether members are expected to observe the seating plan. And if it is just advisory, I do think that leaves open to question the possibility of political parties seeking to occupy different parts of the chamber. And I would be grateful if you would confirm what the actual policy is.
Thank you, Mr. Carlaw. While that is not strictly a point of order, it is the case that the seating plan is advisory and is a matter for political parties and individual members. There will now be a brief pause before we move on to the next item of business.